when you do use these outbound tactics on your inbound leads and you ask them, hey, how do you like the content? Where are you at right now with cold email, in my example? It provides you with a lot of ideas for content, which keeps fueling this inbound engine and keeps sending you new leads via inbound that you can then, when they match the appropriate filters, start reaching out with our outbound tactics.
Hey, what's up, everyone? This is Jeremy, founder of QuickMail.io.
Hey, and this is Jack from emailsthatsell.com.
All right. In today's cast, we look at inbound, but from an outbound mindset. So basically, we ask ourselves, what could an outbound expert do with inbound leads? As it turns out, there are plenty of things that can be done to cleverly move leads down the funnel. In this cast, we'll cover how to rethink contact form submissions, advanced tactic for leveraging lead magnets, and even go after qualified prospects, even if they didn't enter an email. Enjoy.
Jeremy and I talk about deliverability on the podcast, but we created a course that takes a way deeper dive into sending cold emails that actually land in your prospect's inbox.
That's right. And we want to make it free for you. You can find the course on quickmail.io/course, and you're going to find a link there. And you're going to have to enter a coupon on Udemy. What's the coupon for this one, Jack?
The coupon is inbound. I-N-B-O-U-N-D, because that's what this podcast is about. And just heads up, Udemy is forcing us to make this coupon expire after a couple days. So really just grab it now. You'll be locked in for life. And hopefully your open rate will go way up because of the course. So definitely check it out. Today, Jeremy and I were sort of thinking about the differences and how a couple of outbound guys like us could apply what we know to inbound. And here we are.
Yeah, I was toying with the idea of putting a widget on a website with a contact form and automatically filling it into QuickMail to get some automation going. And that's when we figured, like, yeah, this is basically applying the outbound mindset to, you know, an inbound leads. And of course, you know, thinking about it, there is like plenty of application. And we figured out, hey, why not do a cast about this?
Kick us off. Tell us about this form filling automation that you had in mind.
Yeah, good stuff. So basically on our website, we got now QuickMail, that is the normal version, but we also got the QuickMail Next that we are producing. And we're trying to get leads that are more in the corporate space. So a team of SDR trying to do the cold outreach on behalf of their salespeople. And we don't want to talk to everyone. We just want to talk to this particular, you know, persona. So we have a page with driving traffic from a certain place with certain keywords, whatever. And then we're driving them to a page of demo call. And then at this stage, we have a widget, but we still have to sort of enter the prospect yourself into QuickMail and then just start the right sequence for them. And then we're trying to figure out like how we automate that and basically just use the power of, you know, conditional variations and all those things that enable us to send different messages depending on what form or what value people are filling in the form.
Okay, so everybody listening probably has a website, and on that website, there's probably a form on it. But what Jeremy, if I'm hearing you right, there's sort of three levels to automating this lead capture form. The first most basic level is have no automation. When a lead comes in, it lands in your inbox and just follow up manually.
Yep.
The second level would be once a lead fills out the form, they, you know, submit their email and contact information and you manually move them over to a sequence and then they're followed up automatically, right?
That's right.
But the third level would be to have this done automagically. You know, they fill out the form and the name and all the appropriate merge tags are moved into the campaign. And at a perfect minutes past the time they filled out the form, they're seeing the first automated message and it'll keep following up until they get back to you.
Yes. So right now you can kind of do that with the current version of QuickMail and Zapier. So if your form capture actually enables you to do some zaps, then you can automatically, you know, add them to a sequence. And the advantage is to also send a follow-up. So if people don't reply, so it could be like, you know, enter your details if you want some pricing information or whatever about your services. People enter it, and then here we go. Here's the document you're asking, and voila, you get stuff working. But we want to take it like one step further and have it not start automatically. We want to, for example, add some time delay so it doesn't feel like it's a robot sending it, and I want it to be personal. So the ideal thing would be you ask for something on a website, you receive this like nice, you know, here we go, here's your PDF kind of thing. But then also you get hit with a second message just a little bit after that say, hey, we're just checking, you know, and it's like a more personal kind of approach, like you're really like doing outbound, but, you know, with an inbound lead kind of thing.
What part of this process are you qualifying the leads? Because earlier we were having a conversation about, well, if everything's automated, there's a bit of a risk here that unqualified people will be booking your calendar and basically wasting your time. How do you battle this?
Yeah, totally right. So we got some people that say like, you know, John at gmail.com, not even having a company. Clearly, they're not the right fit for what I'm looking at the moment. You need to have a qualifying process at some point. And Jack and I were discussing about like, what's the best way to qualify the prospect? What's the amount of automation that should go versus the amount of, you know, manual thing? I think one of the things that I'd like to point out at this stage is the form can help you. So people filling the form can also help you. And then you have some other decision that you can make afterwards. So for the form one, we have a form that's a field that's a number of employee in your company. And that way, based on that field, we can definitely funnel to one campaign or another. So it could be a campaign that say, you know, less than 5 employees, that's fine, but they're probably not switching. They're not the right audience for us. So we may actually funnel them with like, hey, here's a webinar when you can see everything about our demo, pre-recorded demo kind of thing. But if they say like, you know, 50 and plus, for example, we may want to, you know, send them a link. And then after that, for the meeting, and then after that, you know, having like a manual pass, like you mentioned, to, you know, figure out, you know, do we want to really get them on the demo call or do we want to put someone else?
But a key difference here would be, I might think, as traditional inbound would have these people added to some kind of a marketing automation platform, and they would be getting the white paper that they asked for, or maybe, you know, details that they requested through the form. And then maybe just being added to email marketing messages.
Yeah.
And this is a much more direct approach, which is being automated like you were talking about. Yeah.
But you know what, Jack? A lot of things in inbound, what happened is that all they're interested is building their list. And then after that, they can market to their list. So we can consider like the outbound mentality to the inbound is basically there's a list of people and I want to reach out to them. That's basically what it is. But instead of like being like blank, total cold, they're actually a bit, you know, warmer. Mm-hmm. And the cool thing is that because of all the experience we have about all the outbound, how we should approach people, you know, all of that still apply to the inbound. You just have an easier time.
Yes.
But you can be like fantastic. You know, if I'm like asking for the price list and then suddenly, you know, someone contact me with all the tactics and techniques that we're using in outbound, given that we know what that person is really looking for, then, man, you're going to make a killing. So that's a good stuff.
You bring up a good point here. So there's one key difference between inbound and outbound when it comes to how you reach out to people. So first of all, inbound, you don't have to qualify yourself before you become a lead. You can fill out the form and even use a Gmail address, for example, and in you go. You are technically one of my inbound leads. Now, with outbound, nobody's getting on my list unless they're a perfect fit. So with outbound, I am talking to people who I would be very excited to engage with. Inbound, it's a bit of a mixed bag depending on how good your traffic is. But let's just say it can be hit or miss. Outbound, shame on you if you have someone on your list that is not a perfect prospect, right? And the other big difference here is with inbound, you've got this level of trust that's established. They sought after you, not the other way around. Therefore, it should be a whole lot easier to get their attention. Outbound, we really have to earn it, right? And this whole podcast is dedicated to ways that you can first get somebody's attention and keep it through a conversation, starting from scratch. But with inbound, like you said, Jeremy, if you do follow the rules of outbound, that process should get a whole lot better. But I think something else that's kind of a mentality shift would be if you're running an inbound campaign, you might be driving, let's say, clicks to a webinar or some kind of traffic. But outbound, it's still about conversations. So I think there's a lot of inbound leads out there. And if you're listening, this applies to you. There's a list of inbound leads that you haven't spoken to yet. And outbound tactics can help you get that conversation started.
Yeah, I love that. And bear in mind that we're not saying anything bad about like marketing an inbound, because really good inbound marketer will actually segment their list and their source and so on. But their role will mostly be to do MQL, which is marketing qualified leads, and basically put people in buckets. And that's fine. You may want to actually reach out to all of them, but it could be that more powerful if, as an outbound person, you will consider that as a pool of people and then craft the message according to each of them and basically just do your outbound campaign on a predefined subset of that pool.
So let's talk about that subset for a second, because if somebody's listening, I wouldn't want them to take away that Jack and Jeremy said I should reach into my inbound leads and just contact them like I would traditional outbound campaigns. I don't think that's a great idea. Instead, you want to make sure that you're giving these leads sort of a ranking based on, for me, it's two things. One is engagement. So how active have they been consuming my content? One example is maybe they're opening my messages 5, 6, 7 times each and clicking links. So you can filter by number of opens equals and then a significantly higher number than what most subscribers are doing. So that's engagement. And the next one is quality. It's like you want to make sure you're reaching out to engaged leads that are of a certain quality that you would be excited to have a conversation with. It doesn't help you out very much if you're reaching out to engaged prospects if they don't have a budget or if they're just a totally wrong fit for your business.
Yeah, I love that. You could also spend some, you know, in the example of getting like a PDF, there are some tools out there that let you know when that person is opening that PDF and how long he's browsing on it. And that could be your trigger for your sort of like outbound campaign. So it's basically that, you know, you can go after the whole herd, but you're going to target one or two individuals in this one that actually shows the best outcome.
So let's say, taking a little bit deeper dive into what you just said, if I sent an email with a link to a PDF in it to my inbound leads, and I was able to track who was clicking it, and at the moment they clicked the link, they were automatically added to my outbound campaign. Is this sort of what you're saying?
Yeah, that's right. With an auto start. Yes, absolutely. So you can't really do the auto start in the current version of QuickMail, but that's something I added in the next version. So that's pretty cool. As soon as they get added to my campaign, based on those criteria that you mentioned, boof, they're starting my sequence automatically.
And for now, people could probably use something like Zapier to, at the very least, get a notification or add them to a different campaign. Or what about this? I mean, you and I are big fans of outbound email software that sends a message from my inbox to another, not very different than like a MailChimp style blast. So for example, my email marketing software that I use allows me to segment based on clicks and then add people automatically to a campaign if they do click. But I'm guessing, you know, based on my experience with outbound, it's going to be more effective if you use a one-to-one tool to get this conversation going, right? I mean, that's sort of a little bit obvious to the outbound folks out there.
I think it's fair to say, yes.
Yeah, okay. And so just wrapping it up, one thing that somebody may want to do here is reach out to these, we'll call them very warm leads. And those that click the PDF, you could ask them a little bit deeper question, see how they like the content, see if there was anything else they were looking for. Just start a conversation with them if they match a certain filter, right?
Jack, you're missing the opportunity to coin a term here for like super hot leads or some stuff like that.
Liquid hot magma leads.
Maybe that's a traditional, you know, outreach, outbound email that we keep on saying doesn't work. Like, you know, please enter your credit card number details. Maybe that would work here then with your super magma lead.
It would, you know, definitely work better. So one thing that I've actually done with these magma hot leads is, and I very rarely do this, but occasionally if the lead is a good fit, I'll just go to their company website and pick up the phone and actually get a hold of this person who's on my list that is very engaged and is very qualified to do business with me. And from what I found, it's like when a lead is at this level, they're almost excited to get to chat with you. It's like, oh, it's Jack from the podcast. Cool. You know what? Yeah, I definitely saw that. And from there, you sort of can, I basically treat it as like a very short call to say hi and find out if there's anything else I can do a better job of with content. And 9 times out of 10, this leads to something else. It's like, oh, your free stuff is so good. You know, can you tell me more about XYZ? It's like, I think a missed opportunity if we don't go way out of our way to start a conversation with these, what are we calling them? Magma hot leads.
Oh gosh, not that. Let's call it just super hot.
That's, super hot. That's cool. That's better.
Magma is over the top, I think.
Okay. This is sort of a nice feedback loop here is when you do use these outbound tactics on your inbound leads and you ask them, hey, how do you like the content? Where are you at right now with cold email? In my example, it provides you with a lot of ideas for content, which keeps fueling this inbound engine and keeps sending you new leads via inbound that you can then, when they match the appropriate filters, start reaching out with our outbound tactics that we've just covered. So it's a nice cycle that supports each action, sort of keeps the momentum going like a snowball.
Yeah, another point that we could also cover is more on the technical side is along with your email that you're trying to send out to your inbound prospects, you can also add some, you know, invisible pixel into it. Like that'll be like useful then if that person just registered to your product in terms of a SaaS, for example, and not, you know, if you have a drop shipping or whatever, that won't work. But if you have a SaaS business and so you're contacting that person, you can always drop a quick pixel into it. So you'll know so that this person has a touch by email and so on. And that way you can keep the history and then seeing that people who convert or people that stay longer, like, you know, lower churn and so on, were the people that actually touched by email. So that's kind of like extra information that you can add directly within your email. So that helps you in the long run to know, like, is it like an effective thing or, you know, just inbound on itself is working well and I don't need to add this sort of extra effort. And just as a small word of caution as well as from a technical standpoint, if you're going and creating that invisible pixel for, you know, within your app, just don't call it pixel because otherwise I'll get like blocked by ad blocks automatically. I know it happened to me. So I was like, oh shit, why don't I get any hits? Oh, it's because it's called pixel. So I don't know, like call it pumpkin or whatever kind of thing. And then that way the ad block won't be able to block it.
That's genius. Okay, cool. So at the end of the day, we're recommending getting in front of the customer in a couple different avenues. So you have your website that captured the form, you've got the PDF they're checking out, you've got inbound email, you've got outbound email, and you just are trying to find how to track and stay on top of what's working. It's sort of like if you're playing a board game and you know that this is the end strategy, you're going to want to go for those activities. So putting this tracking pixel will tell us what you need to repeat and maybe more importantly, what marketing activities or sales activities are ending up with a long-time customer, not just someone who's in the door and out the door.
Another thing we're really good at from the outbound perspective is the ability to navigate objections. And so we get objections very often, we get rejections, which inbound doesn't really get used to. Is either you get the PDF or you don't. You know, you get the lead magnet or you don't. You enter your email or you don't. You know, no one's enter the email and say, you know, screw you guys, you know, at gmail.com. Actually, maybe that happens. But you know what I mean? It's like as inbound, you don't really deal that much with that. So you kind of delaying the rejection part. So it's like, yeah, cool, he's on my list. Look at that. I got that, you know, 5,000 people on my list and whatever. But,
right,
you know, if you start asking them something, you get the rejection straight away. So one cool thing you do when you're actually applying this outbound mentality to the inbound leads, you reach out to those people with very key questions that will uncover objections into will they actually move to the next step or not. And if they don't move to the next step, what would be cool is then to feedback to marketing the information so they can either adapt the copy on their website,
yep,
or just remove them in one way or another so you get even better qualified leads. So by doing the outreach directly on the inbound, you're short cycling drastically the learning experience that there is in order to produce even better inbound leads. So I think it's like a really cool cycle to do that.
That's true. So just to be clear, though, I know my inbound marketing friends do deal with rejection all the time. And it usually happens when a less than perfect landing page has been built and you send a couple thousand dollars of traffic to it. And you're looking at this conversion rate that's just like disappointingly low. That's the inbound rejection world. And it hurts almost as well. It can hurt just as much as us outbound rejection.
No. I don't buy this one, because in outbound, that will just be silence and not getting replies. That would be the thing. But we also get we get called some animal names or whatever when we are doing outbound, which they don't get to experience nearly as often in inbound, except maybe within their team if they don't reach their quota kind of thing.
Let's just say outbound rejection is maybe more painful to the emotions. Inbound rejection is maybe more painful to the marketing budgets and bank accounts.
That's right. You know? That's right.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else about inbound or outbound?
Yeah, I got a last thing, which is I would call it semi-inbound. And this is basically prospect that goes to your site, but don't actually act and do anything. Nowadays, you actually got some tools and software that will tell you what company actually came to your website and check your website.
Yeah, it's like reverse IP lookups or something, right?
Yeah, exactly, something like that. So they can figure out, which is funny because I actually learned that some of my competitors were regularly actually coming to my website, because then I could get the IP and then I'd check my database. Anyway, small side notes, and they came on a regular basis to probably study my software or whatever. But it's kind of cool because they also give you some free leads. So maybe you'll know someone from company X browsed your website. So it may be let me check and validate, if company X is a good thing. And that you won't get it with inbound per se, because people won't actually do anything on your website. But you can, at the outbound, check those semi-inbound leads, verify, would they be a good fit for what I want to sell? Mm-hmm. And then reach out to them casually. Hey, I was just thinking, do you guys actually have a need in, product X, or doing, solving solution, whatever.
Conversation started. Boom.
There you go.
Very clever. Okay, so what's the bottom line here? Both inbound and outbound work. And personally, I think every company should embrace both. And we haven't touched this yet on the cast, but I think inbound takes some time to ramp up. Outbound, you are there immediately. You're in front of your customers on, before lunchtime, basically. So there's a nice relationship between the two. And I would say, focus on a little of both. Don't try and be the podcaster and writer and video guy and the outbound guy, because you'll just drive yourself crazy. But focus on a little bit outbound, a little bit inbound works pretty nicely.
Yeah, that could be the topic for another cast, because I think I got a different point of view about, focusing and concentrating on doing one thing. So maybe we'll do that in a future cast.
I mean, I have my Bruce Lee poster hanging up there. So I get the... What is it? Fear not the man who's practiced 1,000 kicks one time, but the man who has practiced one kick 1,000 times.
There you go.
Okay, we'll save that for another cast, but that'll be good stuff.
All right. Great cast. Thanks, Sujash.
All right. Sweet. Thanks, Jeremy. Couple of tactics to take away from this episode. First, use outbound automation to get demos booked with your inbound leads. And if you want to get super advanced, trigger different emails based on the information they submitted in the form. Next, reach out to magma leads, or highly qualified leads that are engaging with your inbound content, to start a conversation. This should give them the nudge needed so that they convert. Finally, use an inbound event like viewing a PDF to trigger your outbound sequence. And speaking of outbound, are you on my newsletter yet? Sign up at emailsthatsell.com/tips to get my favorite templates and more cold email goodies. That's emailsthatsell.com/tips. Hey, cold emailer.
Yeah, you.
If you got some value from this episode, give us a high five by sharing a 2-sentence review on iTunes.
Or Stitcher or TuneIn, that works too.
It's a quick way to help other growth-minded folks like us find this podcast.
So they can send awesome emails.
And make everyone's inbox a better place. Thanks.